students, very good morning. In yesterday's class, we started new lesson, that is mineral nutrition. I hope you all have understood this part. So let's continue the part and let's see the next part from this lesson. So yesterday we discussed minerals are the inorganic salts which are essential for the growth and development of plants. There are a number of mineral elements which are identified in plants. From that, some minerals are there which are essential for the normal growth of plant. They are called as essential nutrients or essential minerals. Fine. These minerals, they could be classified as macro elements or macronutrients and micronutrients. These types are based on the amount, okay, which is required or which is present in plant. So we have seen that there are 17 nutrients which are called as essential nutrients. These 17 nutrients are essential. They are necessary for the normal growth and development. So now in the today's class, we will see what are the roles, okay, and the physiological role functions of these 17 essential elements. We have seen that out of these 17 essential elements, except carbon, hydrogen and oxygen, other nutrients plants absorb from soil. So soil, it is a very big reservoir of different mineral nutrients. So we will have a quick review of that and then we will move toward the functioning of these nutrients. Okay. So we know that these mineral nutrients, they are classified as macronutrients or macro elements. Okay, macro elements. These macro elements are also called as macronutrients. And the second group, that is micro elements or micronutrients. Now I told you why they are called as macro and micro. Macro meaning these nutrients are required in larger quantities. These nutrients are not present in plant. Okay, plants have to absorb it. Fine. So macro element, yes sir, require in large quantities or in large amount. Now how much amount? Okay, if we are saying these nutrients are required in large amount, so there should be a specific amount also. So these nutrients are required in amount which is more than 10 millimole per kg of dry weight of plant. Okay, so more than 10 millimole per kg of dry matter. We know that we have studied about ash analysis. If we want to know the content of nutrients, we have to see the dry weight of that plant, because when we see the fresh weight, it is, or it consists of a highest amount of moisture. So to know the amount of nutrients present, we have to study the ash analysis. Fine. So what amount or what quantity it is come? It is 10 millimole per kg of dry matter. So these elements are called as macro elements. Now micro elements require in small quantities. Okay. Require in small quantities or in trace amount. Okay, as they are required in small quantities or trace amount, these elements are also called as trace elements. So suppose for MCQ question comes, what are the trace elements? So trace elements are nothing but these are your micronutrients. Now we have seen that micronutrients are required in small quantities. Now small quantities means how much? Less than 10 millimole per kg of dry weight. Okay, so they are present less than 10 millimole per kg of dry matter. Fine. And micronutrients are mainly activator of different enzymes. After this point, we will see the types of enzymes based on their functions also. Means what different types of functions these micro and macro elements they perform. But they are they are required or involved in the functioning of enzymes. Okay, so micronutrients or the stress elements, they are mainly involved in activation of different enzymes. Okay, I'll give you some examples also when you see the next part of this. So microelements, these are mainly involved in the activation of different enzymes. Yes sir. Now we have seen what are the examples of this macro and microelements or macro or macronutrients. So let's see which are the macroelements. So macroelements involve carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, yes sir, nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, CHO, NPK, fine sir. Now after this there is a sulfur, calcium and magnesium, fine sir. These are 9 macroelements. Yesterday macroelements are 9 in number, whereas microelements they are 8 in number. Now which elements become under microelement? There is iron. I'll just rub this last point. Okay, there are 8 microelements. There is iron, there is manganese, copper, molybdenum, zinc, boron, chlorine and nickel. As I told you, initially only 7 microelements were identified, but recently nickel it is also identified as a microelement. So now we have 8 different microelements. Most of these, they are activator of different enzymes which are involved in the different metabolic reactions. Fine. Now besides this, okay, now we have learned these are the 17 essential nutrients or the essential elements which are necessary for the normal plant growth. Means each of this, it is must for every plant. Now besides this, there are some elements, okay, which are not essential for the plant growth but are part of some metabolic reactions in higher plants. Such elements are called as beneficial elements. Yes sir, they are not categorized as essential or non-essential elements, but they are called as beneficial elements. So if it comes for MCQ, you have to take care of this, whether they have asked for essential elements or beneficial elements. Beneficial elements are not necessary for each and every plant, but they are involved in some metabolic reactions, some metabolic processes in higher plants. Okay, so they are called as beneficial elements. Fine. So let's see, beneficial elements required in metabolic reactions in some higher plants. Now which are these? Fine. There are 4 elements, okay, like sodium, silicon, then cobalt and selenium. This you have to remember, students. Okay, question can be framed on this. There are 4 elements, okay, which are involved, okay, or which are part of some metabolic reactions or metabolic processes in plant, but they are not necessary for the normal growth and functioning of plant. Now which are those? These are sodium, silicon, cobalt and selenium. Fine. Now let's see what are the general functions. As I told you, these minerals, these nutrients or essential elements, they are involved in the number of metabolic processes. So let's see what functions they do or what functions they perform. So next point we will discuss, that is functioning of nutrients or these elements. Okay, so let's see the first one. Now, first function, we know that carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, these are the structural element. Okay, we know that our structural framework, cell wall, cell membrane, yes, different types of cell organelles, they are composed of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, basic three elements which are involved in the structural framework of each and every cell. Yes, sir. So these elements, they act as a structural elements of cell. Okay, so first function, structural elements of cell. Structural element of cell, they form cell wall and structural framework. And structural framework. Okay, huh? So we know what is mainly involved in that: carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and nitrogen. Okay, these four elements, they are mainly involved, they are mainly participating in the formation of the structural framework or the supportive system of a cell. The next function they perform, they are the component of protoplasmic content. Okay, so they could be classified as protoplasmic elements. Protoplasmic elements could be classified as protoplasmic elements. So carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, sulfur, phosphorus, iron, magnesium. We know that cytoplasm, protoplasm, it has a fluid, so different salts of or the different mineral ions are present in that. So they form the protoplasmic content of a cell, which include carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, sulfur, phosphorus, iron, and magnesium. The third role, some of them, they are balancing elements. Some of them, they are called as balancing elements. Yes, sir. Now, balancing elements means what? There are some enzymes, there are some nutrients which can balance the toxic effect of some heavy metals. We know that plants can absorb the heavy metals, fine. So these heavy metals, they are toxic for the plant because they are not utilized in any metabolic reaction. So they remain in the body of plant and they act as a toxic for the plant growth. So there are some nutrients which can minimize the risk of these toxic heavy metals. So such nutrients are called as balancing elements. Fine. They minimize the toxic effect of heavy metals. They minimize toxic effect. Minimize toxic effect of heavy metals. Okay. Like there is a calcium, magnesium, etc. They can reduce the effect of toxic metal. Okay, let's see next one. The fourth one, some nutrients are involved in the storage. Okay, that plants have, we know that plants have different types of stored food material, either carbohydrate, either proteins, fats or lipids. Obviously, these stored compounds are made up of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, phosphorus. Okay, carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, phosphorus, because nitrogen phosphorus, they are essential component of proteins. Fine. Next one. Some of them, they act as an enzyme activator. Enzyme activators. This is a very important role of minerals, because there are number of enzymes in the body which are involved in number of reactions. Like there are number of biochemical reactions in photosynthesis, respiration, okay, lipid synthesis, and each of that reaction, it is mediated by a particular enzyme. Some enzymes require activators. So these activators, these are the mineral element, and mostly they are micro elements. Okay, we will discuss some examples. The first important, that is magnesium. Yes, first example, magnesium. Okay, now magnesium, it is an activator of two important enzymes which are involved in photosynthesis. The first enzyme, that is enzyme Rubisco, okay, and the second enzyme is enzyme peptase. Okay, I'll write down the full form of this. These two enzymes you will detail, or you will learn in detail when you will study the photosynthesis. Fine. So Rubisco, its full form is ribulose bisphosphate, ribulose bisphosphate carboxylase oxygenase. Okay, whereas full form of peptase, phosphoenol pyruvate carboxylase. Okay, these two are critical enzymes. Very important point, you have to remember this. These two are critical enzymes of photosynthesis. Okay, without these two enzymes, photosynthesis is not possible. So they are called as critical enzyme. Functioning of these enzymes determines the rate of photosynthesis. We know that Rubisco, it is an abundant protein which is present on this earth at the end. Enzymes are what? These are your proteins only. Fine. So magnesium, it is activator of two critical enzymes of photosynthesis. First one, that is Rubisco, whose full form it is ribulose bisphosphate carboxylase oxygenase, and the another, it is peptase, that is phosphoenol pyruvate carboxylase. These two are critical enzymes of photosynthesis. The next example, that is zinc. Zinc, it is the activator of enzyme alcohol dehydrogenase, which is involved in one reaction of respiration. Okay, zinc. Second example, zinc. Okay, activator of enzyme. Okay, zinc, it is the activator of enzyme alcohol dehydrogenase. Okay, this enzyme, it is involved in the metabolic reactions of respiration. Okay, the next one, that is molybdenum. Third one, molybdenum. Molybdenum, it is the activator of enzyme nitrogenase. This enzyme, it is involved in nitrogen metabolism. Role of this enzyme, we are going to study in this lesson only, when we will see the nitrogen metabolism. So the structure of this enzyme, functioning of enzyme, all these things we are going to learn in this lesson only. So molybdenum, it is an activator of enzyme nitrogenase. Nitrogenase is key enzyme in the nitrogen metabolism. Fine. Then there is one more important mineral, that is manganese. Manganese, it is involved in the process of photolysis of water. Involved in photolysis of water. Now photolysis means what? It is a splitting of the or the breakdown of water, or this reaction takes place during photosynthesis. We know that during photosynthesis there is a evolution of oxygen. So that oxygen it is released when water is broken down or split down. So for the splitting of this water, okay, manganese ions are essential. So in this way, enzymes could be act as, okay, enzymes could be act as an activator of different enzymes. Yes, now let's see what other role played by enzyme. Now on this also question can come, so these examples you have to remember. This part is important, that which nutrient is essential for activation of enzyme. Now the next one, everyone knows what is osmosis. In your previous standards you might have learned, in the next lesson also we will study that part in detail. So we know what is meant by osmosis. Osmosis process, it is entirely depend upon the concentration of salts, fine. So to maintain the osmotic potential also these nutrients are required, fine. So the next use, it is the maintenance of osmotic potential. Maintenance of osmotic potential. Okay. So usually at the or whenever there is opening and closing of stomata, at the time of opening and closing of stomata, potassium helps in determining the water potential. At least basic idea you have how stomata function, how they open, how they close. We know that to control the rate of transpiration. So there are the stomata which are present on the lower surface of leaf. Fine. So there is a mechanism which causes opening and closing of the stomata. For that specific osmotic potential, it is maintained within the guard cells. Yes, this part also you are going to study in detail in the next lesson. So just don't take any tension about this. So whenever there is an opening of stomata and the closing of stomata, osmotic potential it is maintained, fine. And that osmotic pressure, it results into opening and the closing of stomata. So for this, for the maintenance of osmotic potential, potassium ions play very important role, fine. It determines the cell turgidity also, that is responsible to cause the opening and closing of stomata. So potassium ions are involved in the opening and closing of stomata. Okay, opening and closing of stomata, opening and closing of stomata. Okay, it also helps in determining the water potential, helps in determining water potential, and also maintains cell turgidity and maintenance of cell turgidity. Okay. Right now, you just think only this point, that K plus, that is potassium, it is essential for the maintenance of the osmotic pressure, osmotic potential, that helps in the opening and closing of stomata. Fine. Then the next and the last use, all these elements, they are constituents of macromolecules. Okay. Constituents of different biomolecules. Without these nutrients, minerals, biomolecules are not formed. Yes, huh? So there are different types of biomolecules. There is a proteins, carbohydrates, amino acids. So they are composed of these nutrients. For example, amino acids. Yes, amino acids or carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, they form amino acids, and amino acids will give rise to proteins. Yes, huh? Then phosphorus, it is an important constituent of ATP. We know this. Then magnesium, it acts as a center of chlorophyll. Okay, in photosynthesis lesson, you will study the detailed structure of chlorophyll. Magnesium, it acts as a reaction center of center of the chlorophyll. Fine. Without magnesium, chlorophyll it is not formed. So all your macromolecule, then phosphorus, it is essential for ATP as well as nucleotides also. Okay, carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, they are involved in the formation of your sugars or your carbohydrates, lipids. Fine. So these are the different types of enzyme based on their use or their functions. Fine. I hope you all have understood this part. So you have to remember which enzyme it is used and what is its role. Okay, fine. Now after this we will start the next part. That is role of elements in the plant growth. That part is very important. So let's see, out of this carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, we will not study because these are the general elements. They are required everywhere and mainly they are the structural and the storage nutrient. So except carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, because without them cell is also not possible. So carbon, hydrogen and oxygen, they are required everywhere. So except those three, we are going to study remaining 14 nutrients. So first we will see a role of macro elements. Now for that we have to prepare one table. So as we prepared before, we need few pages for this because we are going to write all the things in that tabular form. So what we need, okay, I'm showing you how to make the table accordingly you also make. Fine. So what we need first, in the first column you write down mineral. In this we are going to write the name of mineral. Okay, second column we will write absorbable form or absorbed as. Okay, in which form plants are absorbing it. Okay, next we will discuss required by means which part of plant requires it. Okay, in next column we will mention physiological role. Okay, means in which type of reactions it is involved. Yes sir. And in the last column we will mention about deficiency symptoms. Fine. In this way you prepare one table. Okay, we will discuss the deficiency symptoms also. Actually that part I was going to explain afterwards, that I'll explain in detail, but here only we will mention because we know what are the deficiency symptoms. If particular element it is not present, if it is present in less amount than the required amount, then it could show some morphological and the physiological abnormalities, that is known as deficiency symptoms. Fine. So in this way you just make a table. And now we will start to study these essential elements. Okay, let's see the first one. Okay, the first one, that is nitrogen, very important. Okay, the first element we'll see, that is nitrogen. We have discussed what are the essentialities of nitrogen. Nitrogen, it is component, mainly it is component of proteins. Okay, so amino acids, proteins. Okay, besides this it is a component of different cofactors. There is a NAD, NADP, NADPH. These are these cofactors. Fine. But mainly it is a component of amino acids and proteins. Now Now, nitrogen for your study, there is a nitrogen metabolism also, nitrogen cycle also we are going to study. We know that atmosphere has maximum concentration of nitrogen, 78%, okay, nitrogen is present, but plants are not able to absorb it from the air. If plants could be able to absorb it from the air, all plants could have able to synthesize the maximum proteins, but it is not possible. There are very few plants which are rich in proteins, mainly our leguminosae members. Protein, it is a very essential form of nutrition. Higher animals also they obtain or they fulfill the essentialities or the requirements of protein by eating those fruits and vegetables which are rich in protein content. Because human beings are also not able to synthesize the proteins, because for protein nitrogen it is required. Animals are also not able to break down the atmospheric nitrogen, even though not all plants are able to break down the atmospheric nitrogen. So from where this plant get the nitrogen? This nitrogen plant obtained from the soil in the form of nitrate and nitrites. Yes, sir. In detail, we will see how plants absorb these nitrate and nitrogen and how it is assimilated to form different proteins and different amino acids. So, in this chart, only we will see what are the physiological roles of nitrogen, but in detail we are going to study the entire nitrogen metabolism. So mainly they are absorbed as nitrate. Okay, mainly as nitrate, NO3 minus. If you don't know what is meant by NO3 minus, in bracket mention nitrate. Besides it, they can be absorbed as nitrite. So sometimes as nitrite, NO2 minus, and sometimes as ammonium ion. Yes, sir. But mainly the main absorbable form, that is nitrate. Fine. Some plants are there, they can absorb in the form of nitrite or ammonium ions from soil. Okay, this is very important. From where they absorb from soil. So main absorbable form is nitrate, and from where they absorb from soil. Now which region? Now they are usually required by the meristematic region. So meristematic tissue, actively dividing cells, because they require lot of energy. Enzymes, proteins are required for the increased metabolic reaction. So for that, nitrogen, it is also essential. Yes, sir. So required by all parts of plant, by all parts of plant, particularly meristematic tissues and metabolically active cells. Obviously, if the cell it is metabolically active, that cell require more amount of nitrogen. So in such cells, okay, nitrogen it is found in higher amount. Fine. Now let's see what are the physiological roles which are played by nitrogen. As I told you, nitrogen, it is a constituent of organic compounds. Okay, main constituent or nitrogen is a constituent of organic compounds like chlorophyll, amino acids, purines, pyrimidines, okay, enzymes, many coenzymes like NAD, FAD, NADP, okay, as well as it is important in ATP also. Yes, sir. So, being important component of different organic compounds, so it is essential for several metabolic reactions, several metabolic processes which are occurring in cell. Like there is a photosynthesis, there is a respiration, hormone synthesis, growth and all. Because it is involved in every reaction which is taking place in plant. Fine. So, required for... essential for all types of metabolic processes, essential for all types of metabolic processes, like photosynthesis, respiration, cell growth, cell division, as well as reproduction. Okay, so nitrogen, it is essential for the overall growth and development. If you see, as it is a component or the main constituent of all metabolic reaction, obviously if nitrogen it is absent, all these metabolic processes will be affected. So in that case, plant may show some deficiency symptoms. Now let's see which deficiency symptoms we find if nitrogen it is not present. The first one. That is chlorosis. Chlorosis starting from older leaves. Now, what is meant by chlorosis? Just try to understand. These are some terms from plant pathology. Okay, so these are the clinical terms. As we have different diseases, okay, there are names for the different diseases. So chlorosis means what? We have learned that nitrogen is an important component of chlorophyll. So for chlorophyll synthesis, nitrogen it is essential. If nitrogen it is not present, it will affect the chlorophyll synthesis. Yes, sir. So chlorosis meaning degradation of the chlorophyll. So it will result into yellowing of leaf part. So if nitrogen it is absent or if it is present in less amount, it will affect the chlorophyll synthesis. If there is less amount of chlorophyll synthesis, it will affect the overall rate of photosynthesis. Fine. And ultimately, it will affect the productivity of plant. Fine. So, chlorosis, it is the discoloration of plant, degradation or the degeneration of chlorophyll. Fine. This is known as chlorosis. The next effect, stunted growth due to decreased protein synthesis. Stunted growth due to decreased protein synthesis. Now stunted growth is means what? Growth retardation. Growth is retarded. Plants become dwarf. They become short in height. Now we know that for growth proteins are required. If proteins are not synthesized in plant because of absence of nitrogen, ultimately it will affect the height of plant. So that is known as stunted growth. Fine. The next deficiency symptom, premature leaf fall. Obviously, if proteins will be present in less amount, it will result into premature leaf fall or the falling of leaf before its maturity. Premature leaf fall. In some plants, it may induce the late flowering. okay? So it is not affordable in those plants which we use for the ornamental purpose, or which flowers we use for the market. So if nitrogen it is not present, it can retard the flowering also, number of flowers can be reduced, okay, or it may induce the late flowering. Fine. Then purple coloration, formation of purple coloration on surface of shoot axis. Now just try to understand this point. Now whenever or because of absence or the less amount of nitrogen, if there is a reduced synthesis of chlorophyll, then after some time one more pigment that is known as anthocyanin. Okay, huh? Anthocyanin, it is a floral pigment. It is a not photosynthetic pigment. Just try to understand. The beautiful colors of flowers, these are because of anthocyanin pigment. Anthocyanin is a floral pigment. We know that in plants there are different types of pigments which give rise to green color, yellow color, huh? There is a xanthophyll, carotene, yes, but these pigments are photosynthetic pigments. They can involve or they can or they are involved in the photosynthesis. Besides this, flowers also have color, but this color is not because of chlorophyll, carotene or xanthophylls. Fine. This is because of the floral pigment that is known as anthocyanin. Yes, huh? Whenever there is a less amount of chlorophyll in the shoot apex, after some time anthocyanin may form in the plant. If anthocyanin production takes place, then photosynthetic rate will be reduced. Fine. So because of less amount of nitrogen, purple coloration can take place, because now anthocyanins have formed. Anthocyanins have a range from red to blue color. So it gives rise to shades which are ranging from red to blue or to purple color. So whenever there is a less amount of chlorophyll in the shoot, anthocyanins may produce, and because of anthocyanin, those shoot axis, they turn slightly purple color. So it reduces the rate of photosynthesis. At the end, this nitrogen, it is essential for the overall growth. So if proteins are in less amount, okay, then it will result into the reduced yield, okay. So this result in a reduced yield at the end. Suppose because of nitrogen, plants are not mature properly. So obviously there will be delay in the flowering and fruiting, and it will affect the overall growth. Now see, usually now we know that nitrogen, phosphorus as well as potassium, these three are very important component after carbon, hydrogen, oxygen. They are essential for every agricultural crop, every plant. So if there is a deficiency of this, means in what we do, we can apply them externally. We know the fertilizer which we are using, they consist of NPK in that. So nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium, this can be supplied artificially also, so that plant yield or the yield will not be affected. Fine. So this is the first essential element, that is nitrogen. As I told you, carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, plants absorb from the water and from atmosphere. Remaining all nutrients, plant absorb from the soil solution. Fine. So this is the first element, that is nitrogen. Fine. I hope you all have understood this. Okay. Chalo. Let's see the second element, that is phosphorus. As I told you, NPK. NPK, essential elements after carbon, hydrogen, oxygen. We can provide or supply this through fertilizers, which we are using. Yes, urea we are using for plants to enhance the growth. It consists of sodium, phosphorus, it consists of nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium. Okay, so let's see the second macro element, that is phosphorus. Second element, phosphorus. Yes, sir. Now, phosphorus, it is also obtained in the form of phosphate or phosphoric acid from soil. So, either obtained as H2PO4- or phosphate ions from soil. Now, in which part it is required? Now, this is also required in the almost all parts of plant, but mainly in the storage organ like fruit, seed, because we know that phosphorus, it is an important component of amino acid and protein and the stored food. So, mainly required by or mainly stored in developing fruits, seeds, different storage organs, also required by young meristematic tissues and young meristematic tissues. Yes, sir. We know that phosphorus, again, it is an important component of ATP, which is a currency of cell. ATP, we require ATP. ATP, it is act as a currency of cell. So, phosphorus, it is very important for that. Without that, it is not possible to generate the ATP. Besides it, it is also a component of coenzyme like NADP, NADPH. So, important component of cell membrane. Important constituent of cell membrane, certain proteins, nucleotides that are your purines and pyrimidines, then nucleic acid, that is DNA and RNA, ATP, NADP, and different types of nucleoproteins. Now, it is required for phosphorylation, that is known as ATP synthesis. Required for all phosphorylation reactions. We know that ATP contains high energy rich phosphate compounds, or energy rich phosphate bonds. ATP contains energy rich phosphate bonds. Yes, sir. Now, let's see what are the deficiency symptoms. We discussed before, the phosphorus, it is also essential for the protein synthesis. It requires for all the phosphorylation reactions which occur in plant. So it will also result in stunted growth if there is a less amount of phosphorus. Stunted growth or retarded growth. Overall growth will be affected. Leaves become dull or purple. Purple or red spot. On leaves. Now, these purple or red spot, as I told you, these are because of anthocyanin pigment. Fine. It also result in delay in seed germination. Delay in seed germination. Yes, huh? It will also result into delayed flowering. Delay in flowering. Premature leaf and flower fall. Premature leaf and flower fall. Okay. Poor vascular tissues, okay. Obviously, if there are poor vascular tissues, it will affect the transportation of minerals and water, so that overall metabolic reactions in plants would also get affected. Fine. So, this is the metabolic role of, yes, this is a metabolic role of potassium. Fine. Now, this is metabolic role of phosphorus. Okay. Now, let's see the next one, that is potassium. Fine, very important element from NPK. Again, NPK fertilizers. Potassium, as we discussed, potassium, it is essential for maintenance of osmotic pressure. It is involved in the opening and closing of stomata. Okay, so potassium being essential for overall plant growth, it is involved in the maintenance of osmotic concentration in plants. Okay, so let's see the next macro element, that is potassium. Potassium. Now, this potassium, it is also absorbed as K plus ions from soil. Okay, absorbed from soil. Fine. Now, it is required in large quantities in by meristematic cell, okay, tissues, buds, root tips, means mainly those cells which are actively involved in cell division. So, required in more quantities, required in more quantities in meristematic tissues, in meristematic tissues, buds, leaves and root tips. Yes, sir. Now let's discuss what are the physiological roles. Okay, so very important, it maintains the osmotic potential. Maintains osmotic potential by maintaining cation and anion balance in a cell. Maintain osmotic potential by maintaining cations and anions balance in a cell. Then potassium is also involved in protein synthesis. Involved in protein synthesis. As we discussed before, it is involved in the opening and closing of stomata. Opening and closing of stomata. Then potassium, it is an activator of several enzymes which are involved in photosynthesis, respiration. Fine. Activator of several enzymes, activation of several enzymes connected with phosphorylation, photosynthesis, respiration, chlorophyll synthesis, etc. Okay. Besides this, it also maintains the turgidity of cell. Okay. It maintains turgidity of cell. Yes, sir. Now these are the physiological role or functioning of potassium. Now let's see what are the deficiency symptoms. The deficiency symptoms includes scorched leaf tips, yes sir, or mottled interveinal chlorosis. Now, mottled interveinal chlorosis means what? The region between the veins, it become, or the chlorophyll between the two veins, it degenerate, it turns yellowing in color. That is known as mottled interveinal chlorosis. Marginal or apical yellowing or curling of leaf, bushy habit, shorter internodes, loss of apical dominance, plastid disintegration, and increased rate of respiration. Fine. So these are some deficiency symptoms of potassium. First one, there is a mottled interveinal chlorosis. Second one, there is a curling of leaf. Third one, there is bushy habit. Now there are some plants, if there is an economically important plant, that plant it is supposed to grow for a great height, and because of deficiency of potassium, it may turn into a shrub, or it may get the bushy habit. Loss of apical dominance, yes sir. Then plastid disintegration, okay, it will result into the chlorophyll degeneration. And there is an increased rate of respiration. See, if the chlorophyll it is in less quantity, and if there is an increased rate of respiration, then the stored food which is present in plant, it will start decreasing slowly. So ultimately it will result the overall plant growth. Fine. So today we discussed physiological role functioning of three important limbs, that is nitrogen, phosphorus and the potassium. Now the remaining three, that is magnesium, calcium and sulfur, from macro element, and the remaining eight micronutrients we will try to complete in the next class. Fine. So today we will stop over here. You just revise this part properly. Before Diwali, we have to complete this lesson. So once we will complete all these nutrients, then we will see the nitrogen metabolism in detail. Fine. So this is for the day. I'll take a leave. Fine. Good day and goodbye.